Welcome to the first video in my planned trilogy of top 10 games about World War II. Today we talk about my favorite games that depict the Western Front in World War II. So we have France 1940, Battle of England, D-Day, race towards Berlin from the Western perspective. This will be followed by a video about my favorite top 10 games about the Eastern Front in World War II, and then a video about my favorite World War II war games. This is all subjective. This is completely my opinion. It should be clear this is not the best games in these categories, but my favorite games in these categories. So that is, of course, affected by my personal opinions and taste, and also by my knowledge. No one has played all games about World War II, even though I guess some old-school grognards came distributing close to that. I'm not one of those. So, of course, there's also an element of my personal selection that may affect what are the games that I know and what are the games, therefore, that I can include among my favorite ones. This actually is an element that forced this video that you're watching to come out so late. I've been thinking about this video, about this trilogy, really, for almost a year now, since my Kickstarter campaign of 2015, which was a year ago. Now we are in like June 2016. That was May, June 2015. And there was a viewer, which I want to thank and apologize to, William Clement, that as a backer of my Kickstarter campaign, asked that I would make a video about my favorite 10 games about the Western Front in World War II, D-Day, and surrounding events. And it took me so long simply because I constantly had two or three games in mind at any given time that I wanted to play before I committed to this. I thought, well, that game I heard so much about probably would end up in my top 10. I should wait until I played that game. And meanwhile, another game came out. I thought, oh, but this is about World War II and the Western Front. It looks so good. I have to wait until I play that one. So I just realized that, like, the line of the horizon that keeps moving with you no matter how much you move towards, it's like the rainbow that also is always right there, but you can never really touch it. The ideal point where I would be ready for my top 10 never really arrived. It was always two or three games from it. So now, a year from it, I decided, fine, just I'll go with what I have. I go with what I like. There are a lot of games that I like about that. That theater of operations. I still struggle to restrict my selection to 10. So I have enough. I don't have everything, but actually, to be honest, I never will. So be it. And yes, it took me about a year to make this video as one of the rewards for my Kickstarter campaign in 2015. I apologize to William for that. William Clement, this video is for you. But then I also think it's not unheard of that Kickstarter rewards take that long to come out. But again, I wish I had done better. But here I am. First of the three videos, this one for Will and Clement, my favorite games about the Western theater of operation in World War II. So we're covering potentially France 1940, Battle of England, D-Day, and race to Berlin from the Western perspective. And some really iconic elements. Some of these events are some of the most gamed events in wargaming. And we start from number 10 with an event that is one of the superstars, one of the queens of wargaming, which is the Battle of the Bulge. Of the many depictions of the battle that have been made and that I played, I decided to start in position number 10 with Fast Action Battle The Bulge, which is a good game, a very good game. It still is before many other ones. It is not necessarily the best game, actually, in the Fast Action Battle system. The sister game, which is Fast Action Battle Sicily, I like more, and I was torn. Is Sicily really Western Front? It's like more like the Southern Front. So maybe actually with this entry, I'm talking about the Bulge, which certainly is Western Front, but also about Sicily. I'm talking about the the system. The Fast Action Battle System is a system that uses blocks. It is a fairly convoluted, very complex game. Because it has some mechanics that are not very familiar, it's easier to learn new war games when they rely on ideas that you know already. There are a lot of innovative elements here, and there are a lot of specific unique effects that are kind of like not that easy to learn, not that easy to memorize, but in truth, when you become familiar with them, when you learn how to use them well, actually those are the elements that make this design or the system in general so interesting and that deserve, that make the game deserve a place in my personal top 10. It's a system that, yes, is fairly complex, but it gives you a lot of detail, it gives you a lot of nuances, it gives you a lot of options, a lot of different things that you can use, and it gives you a general sense of the events as they happen. It is not overcomplicated. It seems more complicated than it is simply because it will be unfamiliar to gamers relying on time-tested conventions. On the plus side, precisely because of this, it feels fresh, it feels innovative. It is a nice depiction of one of the most iconic moments in World War II, at least for Westerners, at least for Americans, because clearly it is a battle that involved American units. It may also be that this is one of the reasons why it is so gamed. Wargaming, given that there is a huge wargaming community in the US, we have many designers from here. It is a theme that is appealing to Americans. So, The Bulge, definitely a theme that is appealing to me, and that in Fast Action Battle, The Bulge finds a nice representation, one that is gameable, feels historical, and is very rewarding to learn and to play. Number 9, and here again, I don't know if I'm cheating a little bit in including the Battle of Britain. Is it really a front? It happened in the West, it happened as a consequence of the mess that happened in World War II in the West. So, to me, it is part of the Western Front, the Western Theater of Operation, and a classic game about this topic, number 9. It could be maybe even higher if I didn't feel like maybe I'm cheating a little bit including the Battle of Britain. But number 9 of my favorite games about the Western Front in World War II, B-17, Queen of the Sky. I really would be remiss if I didn't mention this, because I like games about air warfare in general. You always have that extra complexity when it comes to the physics of flight. This is a game that is fairly abstract, but everywhere gamer has played it, everywhere gamer knows it. I'm almost tempted to move on, because like I'm talking about B-17. You know what it is about, and you know why I like it, because that's why you like it. B-17, for the one person that is out there that hasn't heard about it, don't feel ashamed, just go and get a copy right now. And then after you play it, you'll pretend that you played it for years and years, so we will never really know that you didn't know about it until now. I'm saying, don't be ashamed, but don't tell us. So, B-17, it's a great game with an incredibly strong narrative. It's one of the very few games that people write logs about, they write session reports, and they're actually pleasant to read. It actually makes sense to read them, because this is a game that depicts a crew of a B-17 on a string of bombing missions in World War II. And it is a system that is basically paragraph-based and table-based, that is, you roll dice and you make some decisions, and those decisions will lead you to move through several tables that will depict events in increasing levels of details. Oh, we got hit, and now we determine where and what damage that caused. And oh, somebody got wounded, and then we determine who got wounded, what kind of piece of equipment was destroyed, and so on and so forth. If you see it from that perspective, it may feel very mechanical, but then if you're seeing it from the inside of the perspective, you're rolling those dice, you're seeing those events, you care about the theme, you care about the crew of these people that are flying with you, you care about the aircraft. The game has an incredibly strong emotional appeal. It's almost like an RPG, and you somehow are the crew. You empathize with all of these members. You get to know them mission after mission. It has just an incredibly strong emotional, psychological impact. it is not so much about warfare as it is about the people that fought the battle. So at least it is about both aspects. It is about the technology, it is about the people, and it is about the landscape, the meaning the warfare context and these people are facing. It's a really strong and solid design from some decades ago. There was a timing of weakness where I don't know what happened. I sold my copy or traded away, and then I got it back. Not the same copy, as far as I can tell, but I purchased another copy because I realized that my life would be emptier and sadder if I didn't have the opportunity of playing B17, Queen of the Skies, when the desire to do so comes. It's such a phenomenal game. If you like games that tell you stories, rare will you find a game that does that better than B17. Since we're talking about air combat, here we have it's number 8, another game about the Battle of Britain. And this is a game that I don't think it really got nearly as much buzz and was not nearly as popular as it deserved. The year that it came out, I think it should have won the award for like one of the best war games of the year. It is beautiful, it is fun, it is smart, and maybe not creating too much suspense by describing the game without telling you what it is. The game is Black Cross, Blue Sky, a big box with beautiful miniatures, meaning the counters representing the aircrafts have the shape of the actual aircrafts. You put them on stands that are transparent plastic, and you change them, and you have dials that will represent different factors, you know, like speed and acceleration and things like that. It is a game that plays on large maps, and you have these large formations of airplanes. So there's a little bit that you have to learn about how to maneuver them, and there's a little bit of logistics, simply moving all these elements and keeping the dials up to date. But if you think about it, when you're talking about games about flight, you do have some records, some record keeping to do. Other games do it through tables and lots of counters. In truth, this is still an economic system. And that's right, this is what I really like about the game, that you have an incredibly strong tactical sense. You do have the sense of the physics of flight. You do have the sense of committing to certain actions. If you accelerate, well, then it's going to be a while before you can turn or perform another maneuver. Because of the specific situation in which the aircrafts are, when they start the maneuver, you can just, you know, pull the brake in the middle of the sky and then go in rear gear. That's not how it works. So you really have this strong sense of committing to the physics, committing to the momentum, and you're trying to do all of these things while, of course, interacting with very hostile opponents. Beautiful components, large map, a large variety of scenarios deploying very different ways from one another. Solitaire friendly, because no hidden information. I haven't played in a while, actually, as far as I can recall, but I know I played it solitaire and I had a blast and a half playing it. Beautiful, intense, and the action is really has a really tight feel to it. The pace, even with large number of aircraft, the action is resolved very easily, and so you still get the sense of the flow, because again, if you have to do too many calculations and you don't see the airplanes fly, you don't have that sense of movement, then actually all of those calculations are lost, because you turned what is supposed to be a simulation of a fascinating and exciting action, you turn that into an engineering problem. And it's very hard to strike that balance between a certain accuracy and still playability. It's hard to do that in games about air combat, and this one does that perfectly. It is very scalable, meaning you start with easy scenarios and then you can add as much technical detail as you want. It is just an excellent game that, from production, rulebook, gameplay elements, mechanics, number of scenarios, is excellent in all aspects. And so I'm surprised it didn't get more visibility, but one of my favorite games about World War II, about the Western theater of operations. That for, and again, maybe it would be a little higher if I wasn't sure, I wasn't unsure about whether or not Battle of Britain counts as Western Front. Number seven, a game, unfortunately, look at what happened to my box. Look what happened. It's very sad that there is a big hole on the lid. When I moved to the new house, I guess that is what happened. I don't know exactly, but alas, unfortunately, the lid on my box is ruined because it has a big hole in it. But the game in it is still good. And the game is Baston Screaming Eagles Under Siege. This is a game in the standard combat series by Multi-Man Publishing, a publisher from which I don't play many games, but I like the system that they have. It's a system that is designed to be simple, very playable, very learnable. It is a system that can be for beginner war gamers. So if you are a new Grognard or an aspiring Grognard, look into that system, because if you find a game that attracts you for the topic, then it is also a game that is very approachable game-wise, at least for the complexity of the rules. So some of those games, nevertheless, can still be pretty big and actually be sort of like monster games with simple rules. So the two things are usually mutually exclusive, but don't always have to be. One of their games in this system they played, the Africa game, Africa with a K, it's very long to play and it's not complicated, it just takes a long time, a lot of commitment. Baston is a game that is extremely simple, but it is also an extremely playable, doesn't take too long. Actually, it is almost, by the standards of the system and compared to other games, it's almost like a micro game, which is not. It's an average good size. But what it does, it is actually depicts a very specific area of operation, the area around Baston. So it's a small scale, really. It's almost tactical. That's how small the area of operation is. Because of this, you also find a couple of things that they seem a little strange and that may irk some war gamers. So for example, supplies are not a problem because at that scale of time and space, people have enough stuff with them to last them until the end of the game. Movement rates are pretty high, so you can move around fast. Again, simply because the area that is covered by the map is not too large. And yet you have a lot of interesting decisions, yet you have problems moving around the roads, yes, you have interesting puzzles when setting up attacks, like massing forces. You all have the interesting elements that are associated with the Battle of the Ardennes, with the Battle of the Bulge, with the Ardennes, and here you see like a small detail. So it's a playable, approachable way to depict that topic, that is depicted in other games more magnificently in a more epic fashion. Who knows, maybe we'll see some other games of that type later, who knows, who am I to know? But here you have that topic, which very often is depicted in large and complex games. You have it in a very easy to digest, easy to absorb fashion that still has a nice flow and a nice pace, and it's really fun to play. Baston Screaming Eagles Under Siege. Number six of my favorite games about the Western Front of World War II. And if you watch my videos, you have seen that I recently covered this in one of my videos, D-Day and Omaha Beach. This is a solitaire game that has a very unique flow, very unique mechanics. Solitaire, but can also be played by two players controlling different parts of the landing. In the game, you are the landing forces, the Allied forces of Omaha on D-Day. Your job is to land your forces, to establish a beachhead, to run against those terrifying German positions, to survive the enemy fire. And it's a game that gives you a sense of despair, which is very fitting to the theme. As your units arrive, they can do nothing, virtually nothing. You have very few commands, the rules are very strict about the things that you can do, and it really depicts well the paralyzing moment of terror that I can only imagine the soldiers landing at Omaha Beach on that fateful day must have experienced. And if you watch the movie Save Private Ryan, that also captures that beginning. All that happens is chaos, confusion, and people are paralyzed. But as things progress, the game gives you more options, then you start having leaders and headquarters that land and that help coordinate movements, and you get more actions and you start pushing against the German positions. But really, it is a game about pain, it is a game about terror, it is a game about paralysis, which are all keywords that you do often see in war games, very often because you're seeing things at a much higher level, strategic level or what have you, where you don't have the sense of the individuals. This game, while not being tactical, while not being man-to-man, does depict that human element. This is what something that fascinates me about this game. It is a game that is not just about the actions and the forces and the physics and the technology and the landscape. It is about the human elements. It is about the human people. It's almost as if, again, the feelings, the terror, the bravery, the moment in which something clicks in someone's mind and the despair turns into incredible courage or madness that looks like courage. That strange alchemy that goes on in brave people under the most terrible stress that they will ever endure, that strange alchemy is captured here. You will have heroes that will pop out of nowhere unexpectedly into the battlefield. You will have units that you will not have enough actions to move, so that simulates the fact that they were so promising, and then, you know, until it gets to the test, you do not know what's going to happen. That simulates the fact that units that you were trusting become completely ineffective. Units that you didn't put many hopes on become very powerful and that become the center of the action. You have this very powerful element of the human mentality, the human feelings. Alchemy really is the word that to me this depicts in the best way that I can think of, this complexity of a million factors that come together in one action. Maybe a brave action, maybe a cowardly action, but you have this sense of a complexity that comes together, that coalesces into a military action. It's a fascinating game, not a game for people that are looking for reassurances, for people that do not like tough challenges. This is a game, expect to lose the game very often, if not most of the times, if not every time. It's known as one of the toughest solitaires out there to beat. And it is not, again, about bragging that you beat the game that you should play. That it should not be one of the motivations for you to play the game. The motivation should be to get a sense of the atrocity and the challenges that happen on D-Day. We know about the events, and now we get a feeling for the events, which is quite a different thing, and something that makes that game quite remarkable to me. We resume after I took a little break, just to get a drink. All this talk makes me thirsty. And now we talk about number 5 of my top 10 World War II games about the Western Front. Number 5 is Band of Brothers by Worthington Games, a tactical game, a man-to-man combat. It may not have the poetry, the philosophical depth of D-Day at Omaha Beach, but it is still a game with a very strong personality. It has extensive designer's notes, and you can definitely tell that it is a game that started with a different philosophy. The designer didn't decide to pick up some well-known mechanics and adapt them to this specific context, or take other tactical games and adjust a thing or two to fit the thing. It feels like it was a game that started with no history, or much better, with a conscious decision to ignore what was done before in wargaming, starting by looking at the theme, looking at combat at the tactical level in World War II in this specific context, and come up with mechanics that would mirror that. Now, that is what every war game does in a sense, but again, there is a certain baggage that comes now from traditional war gaming. So actually, first we start with the mechanics, then we look at the theme, and then we find a convergence, and we come up with and make some mechanics that would mirror a theme. Here is like, forget about what was done before. The designer explains, this is my understanding of how casualties worked, and my understanding there were a lot of rounds that were fired, thousands of rounds that were fired for each casualty, so I'm gonna make fire less lethal than it is in other war games, and I'm gonna make suppression fire the main type of fire, not the fire to kill. My understanding is that combined arms was absolutely vital to actually achieve the kill. So I'm gonna make things in such a way that again, the standard fire is gonna be suppression fire, and it's gonna take cooperation between units to eliminate an enemy unit. So you need to suppress it first, and then you move in. And yes, sometimes people have complained that it almost feels like too much textbook. But it does give a very interesting flow to the game, presents challenges, and also, again, it feels pretty unique because it has a certain sense of realism that is quite pleasant. The understanding of the designer is that the commanders should have way less information than players have in most war games. Then yeah, you have a lot of conceal markers that create a lot of surprises, a lot of decoy markers. Which, if you're in the right spirit, actually, they make the game quite traitor-friendly because you simply place out, face down, a lot of markers for the opponent, and then you yourself, as a traitor player, you don't know exactly what the opponent is doing. It takes some adjustments to the basic concepts of the game, but still, it may work in that way. So it is a game that, if I say, is man-to-man tactical combat, almost man-to-man tactical combat in World War II in Normandy. You've seen that done many times, and yet this is done in quite a different way, a way that is refreshing, that is fun to play, incredibly playable, once you get past the novelty of the ideas behind. And it simply gives you a particularly fresh, particularly vivid picture of tactical combat that you do not have in many of the other cloned designs about this conflict and at this scale. Band of Brothers by Worthington Games, to me, a modern classic, truly. Very different from other games. Within similar parameters, very unique and very rewarding to play. Number four, we are getting close to the top. Number four, actually, we get to another oldie. And I realize most of the games that I mentioned today are recent games. But what can I say? If you look at the highest rated games on Board Game Geek in general, they are all recent games. So either it is just that we make better games these days, or it is that most gamers prefer games that are recent. So we outvoted those that prefer the older ones. Either way, my favorite games tend to be games in the last decade, 15 years, but I still respect the tradition when I tell you that number four in my top 10 games about Normandy and surrounding elements, my number four is Breakout Normandy by Avalon Hill. And I covered this in one of my recent video reviews. This is an area impulse game, one of these games where the map is divided in large areas, not in hexes, and not a continuous space like in miniature games, and where you have some specific conventions that you find in similar games. Usually you activate an area, and then you activate units within that area, you move them out, units get spent. It is a type of system that, to me, achieves a lot of things. I like it in general, and it just so happens that this is one of my favorite implementations of the system for this specific theater. It is a system that works well because you have this nice cycle that units go through as they become spent when you use them, or spent because of game effects. Now, it is not a new thing that you activate a unit and you cannot activate it anymore. But here, the fact that units can get spent because of game combat, because of game effects, that creates certain specific elements. It is kind of difficult then also. It takes a while for these units to pull themselves back together, which is also something that is unusual. So you really have this interesting cycle the units go through, as they may go through bursts of activities, and then they get out of commission for a while, and some units will get back on their feet faster than others. And all this is paired with an interesting situation, which is a situation of a defense, as the Germans are trying to cordon off the area around the Allied beachheads, and the opponents, the Allies, are trying to achieve a breakout, are trying to break through those lines to open holding those. So you have an interesting feel there, because in a sense you almost have a World War One feel of, well, it's a strong front, and there is attrition as players are trying to punch each other, and in particular the Germans are trying to delay and to oppose, and the Allies are trying to concentrate their forces in specific areas. They do not need to win along the entire front. They need to disrupt the front and open a line of communication that cuts through it. But when I said a World War One feel is just, again, because of the general shape of the front and because of the attrition element, which is very important here, which also simulates the difficult terrain that the Allies had to negotiate to push against the opponent. But in truth, it is more dynamic than this, because of the air impulse system. Is not where I go with all my units and you go with all of your units and then you wake me up when you're done, because maybe it took you such a long time to go through all of your possible actions. Because I activate an air, then you activate another one. There is a very interesting back and forth action and reaction as I constantly try to react to what you're doing, think what you're gonna do next. And what is very interesting is that both fronts here are fairly thin. Yes, the Allied front increases in size and strength and mass as the game goes on, as the game progresses, and the German front will be thinner and thinner and stretched out, and the Allied players trying to clearly encourage that, thinning out and stretch the front. But you have the sense of a front which is very dynamic and, interesting enough, very fragile. It just could fall apart any moment, which creates a strong sense of tension. The German player is afraid that the Allied player will achieve a breakout. The Allied player almost feels like a break that is almost a next turn is when it happens, and yet somehow if the German player is competent and a little bit lucky, that element, that goal is not so easy to achieve. Also, the Allied player needs to be careful and protect the beachheads, as it very well should be in any game with this topic. So resources are committed around those areas. It's a really fun and tense game, and that is achieved through a system of rules which is not too complicated. There are other air impulse games which are simpler than this one. This is probably actually one of the most complicated in this system. The rulebook is not the friendliest that there is, but overall it is still a very good game, and it deserves position number 4 in my video for my favorite games about the Western Theater of Operation. Now we get high up there, we get to the bronze medal, which goes to, drum roll, Normandy 44 by Mark Simonich, published by GMT. And why up there? Why so high? Well, it's a very good game, but also because of what it achieves, which is to give me a sense of D-Day, the scale of operations. Well, here you only see part of the map, but the area of operation is not very different between the two games. Here, I just get that with more detail, and yes, with a more conventional, if you want, system, which is an X encounter, but that still works. So there's still a reason why we do so. And you have, like you have in other D-Day games, a specific phase where the landings take place. But then, what can I say? In a certain sense, it's hard to me to almost pinpoint specific things, if not to say that it's how it should be done. When I have a game about achieving the breakthrough, about establishing beachheads, about pushing against the Germans as the Allied player, when I have a game about, as the German player, rushing units around, when I have this interesting tension that both sides are in strong sense of tension, because the Allies almost always feel that they are going to achieve a breakthrough and they don't, and the Germans almost always feel they're going to be overrun and they may manage to avoid that. So you have the strong tension, which I'm going to say, all the things that you find here are here too, with more detail, with an even better sense of historical feel, also with more complexity, but also because of this, with more, with a deeper set of options. If you know Simonich, you know that his designs are very strong, are very detailed, but not to the point of obsession, not to the point of becoming cumbersome. I would say he trails dangerously close to that point where the level of detail, the number of modifiers, the way that zonal control works, it gets to the point where you feel like, one more rule and deal breaker, one more rule and I'm gonna need something against the headaches to keep going. But it gets almost there, and that doesn't fall into that trap. And so as a result, you have games that are very tense, very detailed, deep in historical feel, deep in the challenges that they present, and yes, all of those extra rules and extra special sub-rules and modifications, they also mean more resources for the players to play around and to create attacks and to find ways of exploiting the unique ability of the resources. So they present extra challenges when it comes to make the game work and learn the rules, but they also present extra resources and interesting elements when it comes to integrating them into your strategy and turning them into ways that may work for you, into resources that may work for you. So you find a very nice combination here of complexity, yes, but not excessive, and detail, yes, but again, not to the point that you lose the forest for the trees, that you lose the trees for the leaves, they lose the leaf for the cells, for the atoms. You have enough detail here, but yet you see the picture and you see the action, which is an interesting, fascinating, tense action. The game remains very visceral while still feeling also very detailed. And for this, it gets the bronze medal for my games about this theater of operation. And now we get to the two best ones, and these are really games that are dear to me, that I'm really excited about. And there's this paradox when I do the top 10s. By the time I get to the top, I'm also starting to get tired and thirsty. So I hope that I can still express my unbound love for the next two designs. Silver medal, Ardennes 44, Battle of the Bulge by a designer. You may have heard of this guy, Mark Simonich. Yeah, it's the same. He gets both bronze and silver medal. This is a thin box, but don't be tricked. There is a monster in here. This is a monster game. The map is massive. A game easily takes over 20 hours to play. At least that's how much it took me. It's big. It's heavy. It requires commitment. And it pays off. Yeah, players that are not familiar with wargaming, when I say that a game lasts 20, 30 hours, they pass out, they start crying and screaming. That's not that bad because we don't play them in a single session. We would if we could, but we're not in college anymore, so we have to break it down. And I remember when I was playing this game, I didn't have my gamer cave where I'm filming right now. I set it up on the floor of my office at home, and then simply from time to time I would go there, play for 2 hours, play for 3 hours, go back the following day, play another couple of hours. I was playing it solitaire, and it works perfectly in that sense. And it is a fascinating representation of the Battle of the Bulge. Yes, it is superior to fast action battles, the Bulge. To me, it's superior by two other games that I played about this specific event. I haven't played them all, but it really gives you this phenomenal sense of the challenges that were involved, and it gives that on an epic scale. It's interesting because epic scale, we often tend to identify with, you know, strategic operations. Here, this is not strategic. So you have the epic scale, but you still have the detail. You still see the specific events. You still see the struggle of the units to find their way around the thick forest. You still see the struggle of the units in trying to mass around the opponents when the terrain is so prohibitive, when the weather is so prohibitive. You see the struggle of units that are trying to bring reinforcements, precisely because the map is so massive. The reinforcements that come from one edge of the map, and it takes them a long time to get where you want them to be. And that creates a strong sense of countdown, of tension, as you as the, when you're playing as the side that's receiving the reinforcements, you want those to arrive. And when you're playing as the other side, you have this mounting sense of dread that you think that that may be what is going to sandwich you between two different groups of enemies. The action stands, and yes, that is despite the high level of detail. There are more rules and there is more detail in Normandy 44, and I just said, well, here you've got the system, if you add one more rule, it's too much. And this one adds that rule and a bunch of other ones, and yet somehow it still works, because, I don't know, maybe you look at the map and you're like, monster game, I know what I got myself into, time to go. Or maybe it is just that there is, like, Simon Stas, I really like him as a designer, because you have these games that are very complicated, fairly complicated at least, and not the most complicated ones, but there is a certain elegance to them. The elements, the moving parts of the machine go together, they perform the work well. You have all these rules, you have all of these sub-rules, there is a complexity, but it doesn't feel gratuitous, it doesn't feel just like it's an end in itself. It gives you a strong sense of history, gives you a lot of interesting challenges. All the things that I said about this apply here, magnified, which is an interesting paradox, because you think about it, you have a much smaller place. If you go to France, if you go to the Ardennes, it's a much smaller place on a much smaller map. So there is more detail visually, there is more detail in the situation, and there is more detail in the rules. So maybe because of this, it feels even more immersive, it feels more visceral than this one, where you're playing on a large map and seeing things from the sky. Here you're seeing things from a helicopter, well, from the sky, meaning from above the clouds as a god of war, and here you are on a helicopter, you are flying over the forest, and you see these people that are struggling to reach their position to fight to survive this ordeal. It's a great game. If you have the time and the energy to commit to this game, this is an experience that you'll remember for a long time, that will stay with you. And if you do not have the time and the energy, find them, do something, because you owe it to yourself to play Ardennes 44. Put it in your bucket list, if nothing else. Retirement will arrive sooner or later, and that is something worth spending a couple of dozens of hours with in your life. Just a phenomenal game. Number one of my favorite games about Western Europe in World War II. And the prize goes to... Do you know which one it is? If you watch my videos, you probably think, there's no way I forgot about that game, so it has to be number one. Well, that game is here, it is number one. You got it right. I don't know what you were thinking, but I know what I'm thinking. Number one, my top 10 for games about Western Europe is Liberty Roads. La Libération de l'Europe, l'Ouest, like it says here, or the Liberation of Europe in the West, on this other side. By XSM, the most successful game by this French publisher, and for good reasons. Because it is a game about Normandy that also gives you southern France. It is a game about Normandy that gives you all of it, the whole deal. And this is another huge map. Again, at the time when I played, I didn't have a table big enough, so that also ended up on the floor under several pieces of plexiglass. I played it for several days, or say night sessions, various night sessions, and I enjoyed it immensely. Why is this game so unique and it deserves such high praise? Because it is a game that even more than the other ones that I showed you is about the what ifs of history. All of what gaming really is about this. If I just want to relive history as exactly as it was, then I can read a book. That is still a good depiction. But war games, what they do is don't really give you the story ready-made. They give you the initial conditions. They give you the forces. They give you the landscape. They can give you the possible interactions. And then you see what you want to do with those. And when you have a game about their dance or a game about the landings, then you see different ways of what would have happened if the landings had been a little more successful, what would have happened in the reinforcement later. Here, you can create even more daring what-ifs because you can simply test how the landings would have gone if they have taken place in other parts of France. What if in the south and then they started pushing across the Alps or going north here? What if they started here from western France? That terrain would have been less terrible than in Normandy, but there are other problems. What if they had landed here? So you right there, boom, that's a game changer for me because it allows you to see so many different things, to create what ifs that maybe vastly fantastic, you know, no sane military commander may have decided to go for those, but you still have a sense that if somebody had tried them, then what happens would have a certain degree of realism, would have a certain degree of historical reliability. Because if you do play as history did, as history unfolded, as it played out, then you do have the events that approximately go along historical lines. You do have the challenges that came historically. You have a fairly complex system. You have an extra layer due to D-Day, but again, that you have in all games of this with this topic, that you have a special turn at the beginning to resolve the events of D-Day. But then also when that is done, you still have a lot of other steps. Combat happens in several steps. The combat table has different functions as you switch from one column to another, and then you go back and each column has several sub-columns. There's a lot of detail there. There is a fairly demanding, but not impossible, number of rules. It's all relative. Grignard says it's too simple. Casual gamers say it's too hard. It is middle weight. It's middle size rulebook, middle weight complexity. So it's still kind of demanding, but the action then is intense, and you have again this great level of detail that takes into account the logistics, takes into account the weather, the air support, the mulberries, all of those things. And you really have this sense of claustrophobia as the LA players are trying to push through, and you see everybody else piling up around there, exploiting the terrain as much as possible. If you decide to go along historical lines. And once you play the game as it should be, with you achieving the beachheads, pushing against, opening a way to the east, once you achieve that and you play that for already quite a while, then you can try some daring what-ifs with easier terrain. The Germans don't expect you to be there. It takes them longer to put together a line. But on the other hand, also, you have much longer to go, so that gives them some extra time to set up a line here. It's a game with a lot of detail, as I said, but again, it's not a game that then devolves into an abstract exercise in engineering, into piling up details for the sake of it. It is a game that, while demanding and having a certain degree of complexity, still remains very playable, still actually keeps the attention of the players or player, because it's also soloable, really on the action, and it draws you in, and it gives you this sense, yes, for once we have an epic tone with an epic scale, as opposed to here that we have an epic narrative, almost I would say an epic voice on a landscape is not traditionally epic. Here is epic at all levels. It works well. It's huge replay value. So that also means a really good value for your money. It's out of print right now. It's not all that cheap to get, but it is a good investment. Trust me, this is one of my favorite war games, period. And as far as I can think of the games that I played about Western Europe in World War II, it is my favorite one. Liberty Roads by Accessing. Huge replay value, fun gameplay, historically rewarding, and overall very engaging. thank you for your patience. Thank you for watching this video. As I said, there will be two more coming out in the next days, so hoping I have time to film them. So I'm trying to get them done as soon as I can. One about my favorite war games, about World War II on the Eastern Front, and another one about my favorite games about World War II in general. Who knows, maybe there will be then in the future other of these specialized top 10 videos, but these are the ones that I'm planning for now. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you'll keep watching. Stay tuned for my other videos, my top 10 videos about World War II, and in general about my next video reviews. For now, this is everything. Ciao from me. Keep playing and have a good day.